Hi everyone, welcome back to my videos on discrete-time Markov chain. In this video, I'm going to show you, looking at examples, how we can find the period of an irreducible Markov chain. And a good example to illustrate this aspect is to consider the symmetric random walk on connected graphs. So because, of course, the period of this process is going to strongly depend on the topology of the graph, we need to specify the graphs we want to look at. And natural examples is to look at the symmetric random walk on all the possible polygons, in which case the period is going to depend on the number of sides of the polygon. Second, we are going to look at the symmetric random walk on the five platonic solids. So I'm going to also use this example as a counter example to the previous result I showed. Namely, we know that if a Markov chain is irreducible, positive recurrent, and aperiodic, then there is convergence of the multi-step transition probabilities to the stationary distribution. I'm going to show you that if we have irreducibility, positive recurrence, but we don't have the period equal to one, this is possible that we don't have convergence of the multi-step transition probabilities. So to begin with, let's look at the symmetric random walk on a polygon. So I don't know, let's take for instance a pentagon. So let's assume that we have a random walk moving around the pentagon, and the goal is to find the period. So let's, for instance, call this vertex X. We have five of them. It's clear that regardless of the graph we are going to choose, the random walk can just jump to a neighbor and come back. Okay. So in two steps, you are going to come back to your state. So meaning that P2XX is always positive. But you notice also that the particle is going to jump at each time step. And so if the particle is at vertex X, it cannot stay at vertex X at the next time step. It has to jump somewhere. And so this means that eventually, regardless of the graph you are looking at, we always have that PXX is equal to zero, and P2XX is strictly positive. So the exact value of P2XX is unknown in general. It depends on the number of neighbors of X and the number of neighbors of the neighbors of X, but still it's always strictly positive, at least when your graph is locally finite. So from this, it seems that we want to deduce that the period of state X is going to be equal to 2, okay? Because you cannot stay in state X in one time step, but you go back in two time step. However, be very careful, the period is not equal to the minimum number of steps you need to return to your initial position. That's equal to the GCD of all the possible number of steps you need to return to your initial state. So from that, we cannot conclude that the period is equal to 2. Notice also that if you have a particle like moving on the pentagon, or in general any finite connected graph, because the state space is finite and because the graph is connected, because the state space is finite, and also because the graph is connected, from any vertex you can go to any other vertex, which means that the process is going to be irreducible. So, in particular, looking at the period of a given vertex X, we also look, in fact, at the period of the whole Markov chain, because all the states are going to have the same period. So, now, how do we find the period of X? Well, like I said in the previous video, we need to look at really all the possible paths we can use to go from X to X. So here, clearly, you can go in two steps, or you can go one, two, three, four steps, and so on. So you can basically use any even number of steps would do it. But notice also that you can go all around the pentagon to come back to X. And so this tells you that in this case, P5XX is positive. Okay? So in general, if you have the polygon with M sides or M vertices, let's say M vertices, you see that you can go from X to X in two steps, but also in M steps. So we have P2XX positive and PMXX strictly positive. Now you can check, it's enough to look at the minimal path, and in fact you can check that that for any k such that pkxx is strictly positive, k has to be a multiple of 2 plus a multiple of m, and then from that you deduce that the period of x, which is also the period of your Markov chain, which is irreducible, is going to be equal to the GCD of 2 and m. So GCD of 2 and m is equal to 2, that was our intuition, only if m is even, but if m is odd, those two numbers, 2 and any odd numbers, are mutually prime, and so this means that the GCD is going to be equal to 1. So this implies that, so this is equal to either 1 or 2, so it's 1 if m is odd, that's the case of the pentagon, but it's equal to 2 if m is even. Okay, so that concludes like our little analysis of the period of the symmetric random walk on polygons. Now, before I look at the Platonic solids, I'm going to first show you some counterexamples that we can find from that. So now let's not consider anymore the pentagon, because the pentagon, you see, the symmetric random walk on the pentagon as period 1, it's aperiodic, so we have indeed convergence of the multi-step transition probabilities to the stationary distortion. But if I look at another polygon, let's say the square, then in this case, we know from this that the period is equal to 2, so the Markov chain is not aperiodic. Again, the state space is finite, the process is irreducible, so we have convergence of the fraction of time spent in a state to the stationary distribution. And in this case, the stationary distribution is obvious by complete symmetry of the vertices. Okay, by complete symmetry, we should have that pi is the uniform random variable on the set of vertices of the square. So, in general, for any polygon, and also for any of the five Platonic solids, the uniform distribution is going to be the unique stationary distribution of the process. So, in this case, we have that there is a unique stationary distribution. Okay, this follows from the fact that the process is irreducible and positive recurrent, and in this case, pi is equal to 1/4, 1/4, 1/4, 1/4. So it's uniform on the vertices. Okay. And so we know from the theory that Vn, let's say x, divided by n, which is the fraction of time spent in state x, regardless of the initial, maybe I should use y like we did before in the theorem, so the fraction of time spent in state y should converge to 1/4. And this makes sense if you think about the prime indeed. It seems that we are going to spend like 1/4 of the time in each of the four vertices. Now, what happens when you start from, let's say, this state here, and you assume that y is here, then it's clear that if at time 0 you are in state x, then at any even time you should be either in state x or in this state, which is at the opposite of x, while at odd time you are going to be in y or the opposite here. Okay, so this means that this means in fact that the Pn xy do not converge. What we can say in fact is that the Pn, so Pn, yeah, P, let me see, so P, let's say P2n, we know that P2n xy, okay, is going to be always 0. We cannot go from x to y in an even number of steps, but at the opposite, P2n plus 1 xy, because after an odd number of steps, you are either in state y or this other neighbor, let's call it z, okay, with equal probability, then we can say that at the opposite, this one is always going to be equal to 1/2. So the answer is kind of simple here in the square. If you have a larger polygon, with an even number of sides, we would not have 1/2 here for any n, we would have 1/2 in the limit. Okay, so eventually that's what we conclude. You see that indeed the Cesaro average of this sequence PnXX is going to be, if you look at the average of those terms, that indeed gives you your 1/4, so that's the fraction of time spent in each state. But you see from those two, this example here, that you don't have convergence of PnXY. PnXY is equal to 0, then 1/2, then 0 again, then 1/2, and so on. This is in fact like a very simple sequence, but you see that it keeps oscillating, and so we don't have convergence of those multi-step transition probabilities. So that shows you a counterexample to the last theorem I proved in the previous video. So now let's look at what happens on the Platonic solid. And I'm going to show you again the picture I made so that you can see what they look like. So you see that we have 5 of them, and I'm going to treat 3 of those at once. That's the tetrahedron, the octahedron, and the icosahedron. So the common point for those 3 Platonic solids, so I'm going to write their name again, for the tetrahedron, octahedron, and icosahedron, okay, the common thing among those 3 Platonic solids is that their faces are triangles, okay? So they have triangular faces, so they are connected graphs that contain triangles, so which means that if you just focus on one face, you see that your random walk can again go from one vertex to the neighbor and come back. So that means that again P2XX is strictly positive. But what we just saw also, looking at these examples of polygons, is that you can also go around the triangle, in which case here we are going to get that P3XX also is strictly positive. Okay, so because those graphs contained a triangle, it turns out that the period again should be 1. Okay, so here from those things we deduce that the period of x, which is again the period of the Markov chain in general, z of x is going to be equal to 1. This is the GCD of 2 and 3. Okay, so then if we look again at the picture, you will see that the same works for the same argument is going to work for the dodecahedron. Okay, so for the dodecahedron, we have faces that are pentagons. Okay, so the faces now are regular pentagons, and so in this case, we using the same argument, we have that the random walk can go around a face like that in 5 time step, or go back and forth like this, and so the period in this case is going to be equal to the GCD of 2 and 5. That's again 1, again, because 5 is an odd number. So you see that from our analysis of the polygons, we can deduce in fact that for the symmetric random walk, I mean, it's more general than what I just did here, but the general result we can deduce from this argument is that for the symmetric random walk on a finite connected graph, the period is going to be 1 if the graph contains a triangle or a pentagon, or in general, a cycle with an odd number of edges. Okay? If there is an odd cycle in your graph, then this means that your symmetric random walk on this graph should have period 1. Okay, now let's look at the case of the cube. So, in fact, even if the cube is probably the most popular of all 5 Platonic solids, that's also the most difficult one to understand in terms of period. So, in this case, so the cube looks like that. So in this case, you see that faces are square. So the period of the symmetric random walk on the square is equal to 2. So now, what can we say for the cube in general? What is going to be the period? Well, in this case, I'm going to prove this result, so I can write some equations that are a little bit messy. But in fact, there is a trick, some very elegant result that you can use to compute the period of the symmetric random walk on the cube. It's to look in general at a class of connected graphs, or they don't even have to be connected, a class of graphs that are called bipartite. So I'm going to look at bipartite graphs. So what is a bipartite graph? Well, that's a graph with a vertex set V, and there is a partition of the vertex set V into two subsets V1 and V2, such that all the edges of the graph connects one vertex in V1 to a vertex in V2. There is no edges like connecting two vertices in V1 or two vertices in V2. So a way to draw this graph is really that you have vertices on one side here, vertices on the other side, and all the edges you can find, they can only connect vertices on two different sides. So let's say like this, for instance. But you don't have any edge strictly on the left or edges contained on the right. That's only the way those edges work. So that's what we call a bipartite graph. And you see that for this graph, if you look at a random walk, let me add maybe one edge here so that my graph is connected. So you see that for the symmetric random walk on this graph, is if I start from, let's say V1, any vertex in V1, and here we have V2, you see that at time 1 we must be in V2, because we have to cross one of those edges. At time 2 we must be in V1 again. Then at time 3 we must be in V2, and so on. So at each time step we go from left to right or right to left. So this means that the period of the symmetric random walk on bipartite graphs must be equal to 2. Okay, you can come back to your initial state in 2 steps. Okay, that's what we saw, that's the case in general. But but you cannot come back in 3 steps or 5 steps and so on. At even times, you are on this side, but at odd time, you are always on the other side. So from this general result, so here we conclude that the symmetric random walk on bipartite graphs has period 2. Okay, so as period 2, again, because you need, you always need an even number of steps to come back to your initial state. And now, so to conclude for the cube, so why am I talking about that? Well, I'm talking about bipartite graphs just because it turns out that the cube is a bipartite graph. And so to prove that the cube is a bipartite graph, I just need to define a coloring. I just need to find a coloring of the vertices such that we indeed have our partition V1, V2 like this. And indeed, if you assume that this vertex is in V1, then you skip one and you go here, then you go here, and then you go to this vertex after, okay? And then I'm going to use some red to color the other vertices. So after you have this one is going to be red, this is red, this is red, and this is red. So if you look now at the cube with this coloring of the vertices, then you realize that that any black has 3 red neighbors, and any red has 3 black neighbors. Okay, so this shows you that indeed there is a partition of the set of vertices V1, V2 in such a way that there is no edge connecting two vertices in V1 and there is no edge connecting two vertices in V2. All the edges go connect vertices in V1 to vertices in V2. This means that the cube is a bipartite graph. And so we deduce that in this case, the period is equal to 2 again. So you can do the same reasoning as for the square that we did before. You can see easily that here you have 8 vertices in your cube. So this means that the fraction of time your random walk is going to spend in each vertex in the long run is going to converge to 1/8. But if you start from any of the black vertices, in the long run, you are going to find your random walk in one of the black vertices with probability 1/4 for even times, but with probability 0 for odd times. So again, this proves that your PNXY oscillates, does not converge, okay? And in the limit, you have the lim inf is equal to 0 and the lim sup is equal to 1/4. While the stationary distortion tells you that the fraction of time you spend in each state is going to be exactly the mean of those two numbers, 0 and 1/4, which is 1/8. Okay? So this shows you one more counterexample to the last theorem we proved.